So I usually have to lead this talk off with the disclaimer that this talk does contain PHP, but not here. No. For today, I address the battle-hardened, who walk daily through the valley of the shadow of question marks and angle brackets. And for that reason, for the trials that I know in my heart you have all suffered, I'd like to begin this talk with an exercise in relaxation. That's right. Those of you who know me know that I am the very picture of mellowness. Old Namaste Marquis, they used to call me. So, if you can, if you have them out, close your laptops, put your phones away. If you're bumping into walls in an Oculus or whatever, please take it off, just for a moment. No computers at all. Just put your hands folded in front of you and take a deep breath. It's the weekend. We're not at work. Nothing can bother us here. We're all relaxing and we're unwinding. And no, this is hell. This is my hell. I don't remember how to relax anymore. It's been too long. I don't think I'm alone there. Some of you, as we speak right now, are breathing into a paper bag just because you saw a bunch of little red circles, and I get that. A bunch of you probably just compulsively checked one of your 15 Slack instances that you're definitely in. A stand-up broke out toward the back, and I don't think those people knew each other before today. I get it. I do. Stuff like this is the only thing that gets me out of meetings for a little while. Somewhere in between all those, you know, God willing and the creek don't rise, I get to do a little bit of typing. Up until recently, I attended meetings at Boku. Back when they hired me, Boku was mostly a JavaScript engineer-y kind of shop. Angulars and Embers and Reacts and what have you. Not just working with those tools, but helping to build them. They didn't specialize in responsive web design at the time when they hired me, though it was a part of almost every project they worked on. Performance was always kind of a consideration in the back of their minds, but mostly a nice to have. Now, I am not putting my former employer down here because non-disparagement, et cetera, et cetera. But Boku was, and quite possibly is, the best in the JavaScript business. And they're some of the sharpest developers I've ever had the privilege of working with. Boku didn't write the book on JavaScript. Boku wrote the unit tests for JavaScript, the language, in JavaScript, which is terrifying to me. If you were looking for the book on JavaScript, abookapart.com makes a great gift. I wrote the book on JavaScript. I worked at Boku for a couple of years. I didn't look up from my computer much. I don't know how long it was. Before that, I worked at Filament Group, and you might have heard of them too. They are all performance all the time. They build incredibly fast. This is how we keep time in North Cambridge, where I'm from. They build incredibly fast websites at Filament Group. They did and they do. That's their whole thing. That was my whole thing, the whole time I worked there. So I rolled into Boku all full of myself, like, cute JavaScript stuff, very good. Exciting news, though, now we make fast websites. I am very good at this. I trust there will be no dissent. And there wasn't any, because, like, why would there be? But it didn't actually happen. And that's my fault. And to a lesser extent, real talk, I kind of blame everybody here. I'm spoiled. I've got it pretty easy up here. I mean, apart from the pants-wetting terror. We're all relaxed here, in so much as any of us know how to anymore. We're all ready to be inspired. We're gonna leave here full of new ideas. We're gonna leave the conference full of fire, ready to build things. Point is, I stand up here and I pound my fist on the lectern and I shout, we're all gonna build fast websites from now on. Like, fingers crossed, it's gonna be like Braveheart up in here. People are gonna be throwing angle brackets at me and cheering and flowers, and we're gonna mean every single bit of it from the bottom of our hearts. In a couple days, though, we go back to the grind. And it is gonna do its damnedest to chip away at us. The deadlines will be back. The pressure will be back. Nobody here is gonna disagree that a faster website is a better website. Nobody at Boku disagreed about that either. But our priorities will change. Because let's face it, they aren't always ours to decide. when we get back to the real world, it won't be all about us as developers, no matter how fired up we are now. That's how things played out at Boku, too. I had big changes to make, I had big plans, but everybody already had a lot of stuff to worry about as it was. But I had a plan. Unlike anyone who's ever tried to accomplish anything at work, I was going to call meetings together. That was clearly the solution. So I sent emails, and I filed issues against other people's projects, which were bafflingly unwelcomed. For all my helpfulness, who would have thought I was so friendly? And then I stopped being friendly, and I filed angrier issues, still against other people's projects. Didn't really do it either, but maybe another meeting was the solution. Come to my meeting. There will be no cake. You will sit down. I will lecture you the whole time. People stopped showing up. This went on for a couple of months. I'll be honest, not much progress. Looking back on it now, I know why it didn't go anywhere. I was just adding to the noise. I was another email, another issue, another meeting invite on the perpetual inbox tire fire. Make the website fast wasn't helpful. Nobody knew where to start. Come talk to me about making the website fast was just as unhelpful. Everybody already had enough work to do without going looking for more. Who could blame them? It wasn't a matter of the code itself. Dealing with 1,000 browsers across 100 devices, that part is, in a relative sense, pretty easy. We're all working on those solutions together. We're sharing what we've learned works and doesn't work. That's the reason we're all here. Getting people to care about performance, it honestly wasn't that hard either. You find your own reasons, if you haven't already. Whether it's about just the pride you take in your craft, about empathizing with users you've never met and likely never will meet, or about just going home at the end of the day feeling like you've accomplished something worthwhile, that you've helped move the needle of how the web works toward good just a little bit. Whatever your reasons are, they're not wrong. We're going to talk a little bit about the reasons I care, and I hope some of them resonate with you too. But getting your team to care, that isn't really the hard part. So here's the plan. If I'm doing my job right up here, you're going to walk out of here with a bunch of new tricks in your bags, and you're going to leave here full of determination. Those are the easy parts. The hard part is finding the leverage to push back against the grind a little bit. Against the emails, against the constant barrage of issues, against literally anything that happens on Twitter.com lately. The hard part is putting it all to use and finding ways to involve your teammates so performance is something everybody owns. Nobody's the cop, nobody's the janitor, yelling at everybody to take care of things. This is how I did that, and maybe it'll work for you too. When we get back to work, we don't file issues, we don't walk into the office and call together a meeting. We're not going to give anybody a chance to stop us. This is how I did it, by signing up for everyone's nightmare project. I volunteered to redo our own website. There's a few people just got like haunted looks, like, did it launch? It did, eventually, one of the eight. I started this process the way any professional, responsible, working adult would, and I trash-talked my previous employer on Twitter, no non-disparagement. You should see the Slack channels. In my defense, I did this because trash talking was a long-standing tradition at Filament Group, one that holds to this very day. Mainly though, I talked a big game because I wanted to get the people around me fired up about this stuff. Like, to show that I'm willing to stake my name on it publicly. Like, something rides on this. This is kind of exciting in a typing sort of way. And I am intensely competitive. Honestly though, making websites is just my job. I'm not passionate about putting semicolons in the right places for 8 hours a day, as scandalous as I know that is to say at a tech conference. What I do care about, and what I care deeply about, is building something that I can be proud of. The work itself, that's just a means to the end. For me, that means building something for real people. I don't get excited about frameworks or languages. I don't particularly like JavaScript, if we're being honest here. But I get excited about potential, about being able to play a part in building a more inclusive web. I care about making something that works well for someone that has only ever known the web by way of a 5-year-old Android device, because that's the only device they have. That's the only web they know. This is somebody who might feel like they're being left behind a little bit more every day, without really knowing why. I want to build something better for them. More than that, though, I just don't want to make anybody miserable. It's basically my end goal day to day. A study performed by Ericsson last year found that delays in loading a mobile website caused, on average, a 38% increase in heart rate and an increased stress level roughly on par with watching a horror movie or answering math problems. I don't want to subject anybody to math problem stress just to look at a website one time. Our industry puts a lot of focus on delight, but when I want to book a flight or like check the balance of my bank account, delight isn't super high on my list of wants, especially now that I'm an independent consultant. Booking a flight and checking the balance of my bank account, very high on my list of wants. I want to accomplish my task quickly and I want to get on with my day. There are no shortages of stats to back that up either. You'd be hard-pressed to find a situation where a slower website doesn't one-to-one lead to reduced time, attention, or business. The lion's share of performance work is going to revolve around what's called the critical rendering path, the steps between a browser making the initial request for a document, the website itself, and rendering that site visually. Even though they can be some of the smallest requests on the front end, requests for external style sheets can have the biggest impact on that critical path length, on the time it takes for the website to actually appear to the user. Whenever you read or hear about performance, you'll hear a lot about blocking requests, assets that lengthen the critical path, meaning that the page won't even start to render until those assets have been fully requested and fully transferred and parsed. Any style sheets that we include in our markup, with the exception of branding, any style sheets we include in the head of the page, for sure, in any browser, will prevent the page from rendering until those assets have been fully transferred and parsed. The same goes for any JavaScript files that we include in the head of the document, but not for any JavaScript files that come after all of your markup. This is the behavior for style sheets in Chrome now as well, like brand new Chrome. That can lead to surprisingly big rendering delays, especially in the case of style sheets that don't immediately apply to the user's browsing context. Even if we're conditionally applying style sheets based on the contents of a media attribute, they'll still block render. Even if a style sheet doesn't apply, and it could never apply, the browser will prevent the page from rendering until that asset has been fully downloaded. There's a good reason. Media queries, per the spec, are designed to respond to changes in user context, window size, resolution, and so on, the way we all use them. If we didn't load a style sheet until a media query applied, we could end up with a flash of unstyled content whenever the user's context changed, like if they resized the viewport. Worse, if their connection dropped out at some point before that resize, they could get stuck with no styles at all. The good news is that some modern browsers, again brand new Chrome and I think brand new Firefox, will raise or lower the priority of a style sheet depending on that attribute. Deprioritized requests won't block render. The page will be rendered and then they'll be requested asynchronously after the fact. In those browsers, the style sheets that are necessary to render the page right away do still block, because they have to. The others will be loaded afterwards. The critical CSS approach, which, like, quick show of hands, has anyone heard the term critical CSS before? I know Kadam's hands up because I just kept yelling at him about it at Boku. The critical CSS approach takes that logic one step further. It determines programmatically what styles are required just to render the page, to make it look visually complete, and pulls those styles into the head of the document. The first step in the critical path in requesting a website is the initial round trip from the server to the browser. And that new TCP/IP connection can include up to 10 TCP packets, which is about 14 kilobytes of data. That's usually more than enough to get all of our markup into the browser, so the browser can start determining what other requests need to take place to render the page. By putting our critical styles in the head of the page, we can end up delivering a visually complete page in as much time as it takes to make that initial TCP/IP connection. It's instant fast. Then, we defer any requests for the style sheets that are required to render the rest of the page to make everything look right until a fraction of a second after that first render. It makes a tremendous difference, a surprising difference in a site's performance. It's what appears to be a fully rendered website in the time it takes for the browser to say, I'd like to see this website. I'm not bragging or anything. But if you go to boku.com, once the cache is primed, if you hit reload, nothing happens. There's no blank browser window. It's just there, because that initial connection covered all of it. As the page first loads for the user, everything seems more or less normal. Not all of our assets are there just yet, but nothing really looks off layout-wise. If we were to freeze the process of loading the page right here, with only our critical CSS up in the head of the document, but not the remainder of our style sheets, we'd see that a lot of the styles necessary to render the page properly are missing. They're just not there. We'll still load the rest of those style sheets, of course, but we'll do it in a way that doesn't block the page render. There are some brand new standards in the works that allow us to load style sheets asynchronously at the browser level, consistently, manually, by opting in. They're not quite ready yet, so for the time being, I still use a little bit of JavaScript to do this. With that critical CSS approach in play, the head of our pages would look something like this. We'll have a huge, scary, nightmarish block of critical CSS inlined in the head of the document, followed by that load CSS script. We call that function with the path to each of our full CSS files, and they're all loaded asynchronously, but quickly enough that there's no visual lag, even if the user tries to scroll really fast once the page loads. Since combing through a style sheet for all the styles we need to render at the top of our page is a nightmare, especially in terms of ongoing maintenance when you have a bunch of stuff in the head of the page, I've always automated this process with a grunt task. There is a Webpack task that does this too that I am looking forward to getting completely wrong the first time I try it, because Webpack, but in theory. I like to think that we came up with a pretty clever approach to this using grunt. Site that we wanted to enhance with critical CSS, we would add a configuration for that page type in the grunt file. That task would generate a file named for that page and drop it into a critical subdirectory off the CSS directory. Because we were using Vagrant, our local dev environments matched the way the site would be built on the server side by grunt. So here we determine the current URL, local or remote, and we pass it directly to this task. So these files now get generated on the server the same way we have them set up locally. There's nothing to upload, there's nothing to commit, it just happens once we deploy the site. Full disclosure, I do not know how to do computers good. I don't know if I've made that plain enough over the course of this talk so far. I can put together a grunt task pretty okay. I've minified some CSS in my day, but I don't have any real background in deployment. Boku did. Boku had tons of people who were experts at deployment. This gave me an opportunity. This gave me a meaningful issue to file. Help me accomplish this thing, this very weird, very specific thing, and here's why. With this, our critical CSS is generated on the server. We never have to think about it again. We never have to maintain anything. It's just a task that runs independent of us. From there, adding any sort of manual step to the build process, like, once the critical CSS is generated, just copy it here or add a link to this here manually would have been doomed from the start. It just never would have happened. Instead, we made the website smarter about how those files are loaded. Instead of a plain old link to the style sheet in the head of our documents, we generate that markup using a PHP function. At the time the page is rendered, I warned you about the PHP. At the time the page is rendered, this function sees if there's a critical CSS file that matches the current page style. It then goes and it fetches the contents of that file, and it checks to make sure it actually got something out of it, just in case, you never know. Then it determines whether we've set a cookie saying that our critical CSS has already been loaded. This cookie serves as a proxy for the state of the browser cache, for want of anything better at the time that could communicate from JavaScript to the server. If we've already loaded a page, that means we're pulling our CSS from the browser cache, which is pretty fast as it is, and this isn't really a huge concern. If this is our first time loading a page, we'll have to fetch our style sheets from the server. This function drops the contents of that critical CSS file directly into the page's markup, then goes on to inject our load CSS function, the rest of our style sheets, and set that cache proxy cookie. I include this JavaScript in the head of the document too, because I don't want to introduce a new blocking request. And this is only a couple of bytes off that initial 14 kilobytes. Full disclosure, my PHP is dubious at best. I could write this function, I could not write it well, and at one point I did write this function and I did not write it well. This gave me another specific issue to file. I asked Jen Schiffer to help me out with it. I had a specific task, I had an excuse to dig into the reasoning behind it, I had an opportunity to elevate this stuff to everybody on the team. Hey, I want to put a huge block of inline CSS in the head of the document, can you help me do that? For sure, garners some questions. Jen asked that I represent her contribution to the project visually using the Google Images results for the phrase cool lizards. It's Jen Schiffer, everybody. Once we had the page showing up as quickly as possible, we can start looking for more specific points of failure. And believe it or not, just showing our web fonts is probably the biggest one. There's no Media Temple sponsors, right? Most browsers will wait about 3 seconds for a font to load before giving up and just showing the fallback text, which in performance terms, 3 seconds is a lifetime. Older WebKit-based browsers, in particular old Android, old iOS, BlackBerry, believe it or not, they'll wait up to 30 seconds before showing any text at all with web fonts in play. This is a massive single point of failure for a site, no matter how fast it is otherwise, no matter how quickly it gets the first render. That doesn't do you any good. FontFace has a very smart syntax. The fallback pattern is built in, so no matter what format a browser needs, we're only looking at one request asynchronously for each file, and that's smart. I don't want to mess with that. For a while, I did advocate loading all of your font files asynchronously using data URI massive style sheets. And that still works, but it's not all that fast. The issue isn't loading the fonts so much as applying them to the page. If our style sheet calls for text to use a font that isn't available at render time, that text won't be shown until the font is available. So instead of messing around with font face and potentially breaking a really smart loading pattern, the font event spec gives us a JavaScript API that tells us when our font files are fully loaded. We can then apply them to the page after the fact. Since they're not being applied during initial render, they won't block the text from being rendered. That API is surprisingly simple. It's a couple lines of JavaScript to say, once all the fonts are fully loaded, bolt a class onto the HTML element. Then in our CSS, we qualify the web font family with that class. And that's it. You are now done with asynchronous application of web fonts. You've removed that single point of failure with 6-7 lines of code. The caveat here is that you might see your fallback fonts for a split second before the web font is loaded. But I honestly consider that a feature. Whatever it is your user wanted to read, the reason they came to that site, the thing they needed to see, will be there no matter what, no matter what request fails. This is a brand new spec. I think natively it's only in Chrome. Bram Stein put together a great polyfill for it that, like, don't leave home without it. Every project I've been on for Perf, this has made its way in for sure. We optimized this a little further, the same as we did with our critical CSS, by setting a cookie the first time our fonts are loaded. Avoid the JavaScript solution altogether if the cache is already primed and you can just pull the fonts from there. That'll be really, really fast. For as simple as that is to implement, asynchronous font application is a shockingly complex topic. There are new approaches rolling out constantly, and new standards are being developed as we speak that would allow us to control that finer-grained tuning. The approach I'm most excited about, and the one I used most recently, is called Critical Web Fonts. Just like the name implies, this approach uses the same kind of like smoke and mirrors, look over here jingling the keys at the user magic trick as critical CSS did. We progressively apply our fonts in a way that sort of hides our performance machinations from the user when they first hit the page. Instead of showing our fallback fonts until we finish loading the full web font and all of its weights and all of its styles and all of its alternates, we load a subset of that font. A font file containing just letters, numbers, basic punctuation in the base style and weight in medium or book. The full fonts are still loaded at more or less the same time, and we're still not hiding any text from the user in either case, we do manage to chip away at some of the time the user might spend looking at a fallback font, showing them something that's more representative of the web fonts. Now again, showing the user a split second of unstyled text is not the end of the world, and it's sure as hell better than stopping them from whatever it is they need to do. But having all those fonts snap in at once after the fact can cause a pretty major reflow in terms of pure performance, and it could be jarring in terms of usage. Partially though, this approach is for us. This is for me, because I like web fonts. I want users seeing our design as it was designed. I don't want to compromise on that. If we're clever about what we show the user and when, we really don't have to. For generating the subset of fonts, you can tell which GitHub screenshots are old and which are new by the bar at the top, if anyone's keeping score. For generating the subset of fonts, you have a couple of options. If you're self-hosting, Zach Leatherman's Glyph Hanger, terrible, is a command line tool that'll generate all your subsetted fonts from a single TTF. You just run this on the command line, point it at that TTF file, and it generates all the WAF, WAF2, TTF in the subset. Typekit and Google Fonts both give you the option of subsetting if you're using either of those. If you're not 100% comfortable in command line turf, like I like to look at a picture and click on the thing I want it to do, Font Swirl will allow you to upload and subset web fonts and then generate all the formats you need from that. All told, this step, even though it sounds a little weird, doesn't really add much overhead. Like, how often day to day do you need to go back and tinker with your font files and change their subsetting? Once these have been generated, it's kind of a one-time thing. Once we've generated those subsetted fonts, implementation is almost identical to the handful of lines of JavaScript and CSS you saw a minute ago. But it works in two stages. First, same as before, JavaScript applies a class to the document once our tiny subsetted font files have finished loading. We then do the exact same thing with our full-sized font files and all their alternate weights and styles. Once all those fonts have loaded, add a different class to the body. CSS does everything else. It doesn't add much more, especially if you have all these hooked up to like a mix-in somewhere. First, our web fonts are qualified by the subset class. Then, once all the other font files have finished loading and all the fonts are available, the second class is applied. The subset styling is then hidden, you get real fonts. It's a little bit trickier than what we're using on Boku.com, and I don't know that I'd go back and change what we have now. It's a fast site, and it works pretty well. This wouldn't have taken much more time to implement, though, and this is how I do things now. These days, because it's the future, I have foregone the cookie approach for session storage, which has the benefit of keeping all of our concerns in JavaScript territory, not handing things back and forth between PHP and JavaScript via cookie. It is infinitesimally slower than adding those classes on the server side, but it's way easier to implement, and it's way more maintainable. I inline all of this in the head of the document, so we're not introducing any blocking requests for any of the font logic. In fact, the subsetted font files, depending on the font and depending on the subset, are usually small enough that I'll base64 encode those and include those in the head of the document as well. Those are available as soon as the document is parsed. That subset class is applied immediately, usable styled text that is later replaced by our full web font families. Show of hands. Who saw this subject coming from me? Yes. Yes, that's right. It's time to talk about responsive images, and I'm going to detail how our merry band of developers, led by the illustrious chair of the responsive images community group itself, speckers of the responsive images specification, implemented responsive images on Boku.com. Are you ready? We used WordPress and we were done. There is technically a little more to this story. I did a little bit of tinkering with our specific implementation because I'm obnoxious. I didn't do very much. The bottom line is that the tooling around responsive images has gotten really, really good, and not for nothing, that was the long con. If you're familiar with that markup, with those syntaxes, it's kind of a bear. It's nightmarish stuff. The goal was, from the outset, to come up with something that we could automate, that we could bake into CMSs so we never have to think about it again. It's there, and that's tremendously exciting because I don't know about you, but I am super sick of hearing me talk about responsive images, and now I don't really have to. So after everything we've done, it is incredibly important that we don't consider our performance work finished. A few blocking requests added carelessly or an uncompressed ping uploaded somewhere on the site and we are in trouble again. Performance budgets help us keep things in check. Everybody's familiar with unit testing, right? Like that reference earlier was, okay, there's nods and that's good enough for me. Nobody's in trouble, nobody's seen me after class. This performance budget grunt task works like a unit test. If you've gone over your budget, your build process fails. It just falls apart on you and says, no, try again. If and when this task fails, you have to take a hard look at that new image or feature or carousel or mission critical flash intro or whatever somebody added to the site without your seeing it. You have to either get rid of it, make it smaller, or make up the difference somewhere else. This absolutely did not work for us at Moku. In order to run this task, it needs a public-facing URL, which meant local tests running against the live website. Stopping the build locally will not do us any good if something's broken on the live site, especially in the case of somebody uploading something they weren't supposed to. In fact, a lot of times, it would prevent us from fixing the thing that was causing the error and deploying it. So we went with a completely external service. Caliber runs scheduled performance tests against the live site and notifies us whenever it goes over budget, whether that's something in the code, something in an upload, something on the server side. It ensures that the performance testing we're doing is testing against real-world conditions. Time to first byte, uploaded content. If something breaks, we're all notified, and we can push a fix right away. For Boku.com, we only budgeted against Speed Index, which webpagetest.org uses as sort of a, like, summary of a bunch of different performance conditions on the site. In a company full of web devs, that was plenty. We knew something was wrong, track down which commit caused it, not a big deal. For a recent publishing client of mine, we put together an extremely in-depth, multifaceted performance budget, but they didn't really have anything to base those figures on. They'd never done any real performance testing prior to this, so we took a bunch of averages across a bunch of their known competitors. So at the very least, we're starting out saying, okay, at least above average, all the time. We'll further refine these numbers as time goes on, as we make improvements, as the averages come down a little bit for them. Etsy, no pressure, streams their live site's performance stats to a display on the wall. I didn't get a chance to do this at Boku, and it would be a little weird as an independent consultant if I did it at home. That's my Persona 5 playing machine, not for work. Phantom Thieves, anybody? So what did all of this get us at Boku? It got us a very fast website. There is no disputing that, if I may say so. More than that, this project showed everybody at Boku what we'd be able to accomplish performance-wise. It was a little more work, sure, but it was the kind of work that led to a real measurable result right away. No open-ended GitHub issue that said do performance could ever have resulted in that. That one point, if you're wondering, I know you're all wondering, that's Google Analytics script, has near future header set, which makes sense, sure, but like, just one point, it's Google's tool, just discount that, just give me the 100. It's fine, I don't still check this every once in a while, whatever, not a big deal, I don't even work there anymore. Boku.com earned us some bragging rights, absolutely. And a little friendly competition never hurt anybody, for sure. More than any of that, though, that underlying message, that we as a team could build something that was faster than anyone expects, something that works for everyone, that message resonated with the team. It's something everybody on the team started owning, some in small parts and some in larger ones. We might have gone our separate ways, but they're carrying that message with them now to new projects and new teams. I'm running a user empathy pyramid scheme here. They're gonna hand it on to the people they work with. I hope everyone here is on board too. I hope you're all in with the pyramid scheme. I hope we all manage to beat back the tide a little bit, to find little points of leverage here and there to push back against the emails, the issues, the meetings, the little red notification bubbles. I hope we all manage to find ways to guide the web towards something better, faster, and more inclusive. And then I want you to get on Twitter, and I want to hear specifically about how you're going to kick my ass at it. Thank you. So I think we do have question time, yeah? 5 minutes of question time.
Hey. So, I don't know if I believe this or if it's understood, but I didn't really get a pretty precision about like how you actually figure out which is written, which is the sword, the code for doing something that you didn't seem to be in.
Yeah, it's automated to the point where I don't know, which is great. That's my favorite function of computers, is doing stuff I will never hope to understand. The gist is, like that grunt task, you pass it both a URL and the path to the style sheet. It'll render the page headlessly, still in Phantom.js from like 1987, but what can you do? I'm not bitter. It kind of cross-references the styles within the viewport of that rendered site against the style sheet and teases it apart and throws all that in a separate file for you. Because otherwise you're like inspecting element and being like, this has a border, so, which nightmare. Where it gets dicey is like the webpack thing I'm a little skeptical of, because it does need something to look at to do that. And I don't know if webpack will be far enough along in the build process to have something look at-able. So that's maybe something that needs to live in like grunt gulp territory. I accept questions on amateur boxing, basic carpentry, baking, except I'm cutting weight for a fight at the end of the month, so I don't really want to hear about bread at this time. But it's tough. It's tough. No? Okay. I think that's it then. Thank you, everybody. Oh, there's a break now? Should I announce it? Yeah, there's a 10-minute break, if you are so inclined.